So this is another reader specific bug, and it doesn't affect any other readers, including yours. So no need to worry if you are using any other software. Yeah, all platforms. So first few words about me. Most of the time I worked as a JavaScript developer, and that's why I'm interested in this kind of bugs. And nowadays I'm working with mobile related stuff at a startup company. But this talk is not going to be about malwares. It is going to be about vulnerability. And it was fixed in May. And I'm going to talk about the whole lifespan of this bug from the beginning by introducing the basic JS stuff that you have to know to understand what's going on. And at the end, I will show you how they fixed it finally. So there was another talk by me about similar stuff, but there are several differences. It is available on YouTube, you can watch it, but it is Hungarian, so I guess some of you wouldn't understand it. And this is about JS bugs in general, and I presented a Firefox and an Adobe Reader example, but didn't actually release code. And this is going to be different because now I uploaded to GitHub the whole thing. I mean, the proof of concept and everything else. And the main difference is that there were a lot of cats in that presentation, and now I'm not going to use too much cats. These are the only cats this time. So, first of all, the JavaScript basics that you will need to understand in order to understand the bug. So here I've defined two functions, and there's a function, there's a variable assignment, and that shows that in JavaScript functions are first class variables, first class values. You can pass them around, you can assign them to variables, and that's something that is not like this in most other languages like Java or other widespread languages.
The comment is incorrect, I guess. It should be,
really?
It should be 6, not 300. So that's the one question.
Yeah, you were right.
Okay, it's wonderful.
Cool. Yeah, so the third function is identical to the first one, yes. So, what about objects and methods? Objects are like key value pairs, and the keys are strings. The values can be anything, including functions. So when you have a function as a value for a key, then you are talking about a method, basically. And here's an example. Always an object, and you assigned o.f a function, and then you call it. And then this function, this method, prints the this.a value and the parameter value. And an interesting thing is that this is just a hidden parameter in JavaScript, and you can change its value this way. So when you call this, so when you use this call method on the function itself, because the function is an object too, then you can manipulate the this value. And, this will be important in the second half of the presentation. Okay, and you can define properties. Properties look like ordinary values on object, just like the A in the first line, but properties are in fact backed by functions, getter and setter functions, and this is how you define it in SpiderMonkey related engines. And since JavaScript, since Adobe Reader uses a SpiderMonkey engine, you can do this this way in Adobe Reader. So in this case, you define B by defining a setter and a getter function. And when you assign a value to B, the setter function is called, and when you query the value of O.B, then the getter function executes. So JavaScript is great, and Adobe Reader is a good PDF reader, and Salmon had the great idea that we should combine the two to get an even better PDF reader, and turns out it was a terribly bad idea in the end, because I've never seen any PDF that uses JavaScript for something useful. Put up your hand if you've seen any PDF that uses JavaScript for something useful.
You can start the calculator.
Yes. Maybe Adobe Reader is the best platform for that application. Who knows? Okay, so I was very interested in this JavaScript-related stuff, and so I started to dig into the documentation and found this architecture. It is public. So you have a sandbox outside, and then in the sandbox, you have a JS engine, and the JS engine is what executes the code in the PDF. If you have JavaScript code in a PDF, it can also execute utility scripts, like you can automate most of the thing you would do with Adobe Reader. You can do can write batch-like automation scripts, and you also have signed PDFs that have access to much broader set of APIs. Just like utility scripts, which have access to a broader set of APIs than regular JavaScript code. It is SpiderMonkey from Firefox, basically. And then you have some APIs that is accessible to JavaScript code that is in fact implemented in JS itself, and that JS code accesses an extended set of APIs also in order to be able to implement the higher API that it presents. So well, these different kind of scripts run in the same runtime, and this is basically the source of the basic flow of the architecture, because you have to have a lot of APIs that are accessible only to utility scripts and you know, these privileged stuff, and you run in the same engine the stuff that is unprivileged, and you have to prevent the unprivileged JavaScript code from accessing the privileged APIs. So they came up with a solution. These are examples of the APIs that are privileged. For example, file I/O and network access. And they came up with the notion of trusted functions. These are the functions that are the only ones who can call these privileged APIs. And there is a few root of trust here. So for example, utilities scripts, and in the init script is the root of trust, and then they can call a function called app.trusted function to make other functions privileged. So for example, in this case, the utility scripts script makes the F6 privileged and trusted, and from that point on, the F6 function can call privileged APIs. And the others can't. I mean, F1, F2, and F7 can also call privileged APIs. So, when I read about this, then my first thought was that these scripts have to be very careful not to give away this property, I mean the trusted property, because if they are not careful enough, they might make functions trusted even if they didn't want to. So let's see an example of a buggy code, buggy function that is trusted and can make other functions trusted by accident. So this function, called API function, gets three parameters. One is an object, the other is a name, the third is a parameter. So the first one is supposed to be an object on which there is a method defined by the name cbName. And then, so this trusted function calls the callback on the fourth line, and the problem is that you can specify parameters that make an arbitrary function privileged, I mean trusted. So if the first parameter is app and the second is trusted function, then the callback call will be actually translated to app.trusted function, and they will call this function on f. So this function will make our f privileged. So this is a made up example, and
the x in the script above is
actually yeah. So this one here is param. Yes. So cb object is app and cb name is trusted function. So this line here becomes app.trusted function f. And here we go. We've got a trusted function and we do anything we want. So this was a made up example, but let's see the actual init code, how it looks like. Maybe we can find some vulnerable functions that are similar. So I looked at the init JavaScript code, and what I found is that it is basically a binary file and was not able to figure out its format for a long time. It looks like this. First few bytes look like this, and so the file utility didn't know this format, and I just couldn't find anything about it on the internet, but after a little more research, I realized that if you interpret it as a series of 4-byte little endian integers, then the first 4-byte little endian integer is dead at 7, and that must be that mustn't be accident. So that is something that you can Google on, and you will find some code. And it turns out to be And then I found that the Linux version of Adobe Reader contains this script, which means that it is actually running SpiderMonkey 1.8. And it turns out that the DAT7 is the signature for the SpiderMonkey 1.8 serialization format. So this is SpiderMonkey 1.8 XDR bytecode. And the interesting thing is that SpiderMonkey 1.8 was used in Firefox 3, and Adobe Reader uses this same engine until today, 5 years old engine. So that's the compiler bytecode. So I wrote a tool that is published on GitHub now, and its output is about 22,000 lines of JavaScript. This is the init script of Adobe Reader 11, and you can imagine that this 22,000 lines of code may contain some bugs. One or more bugs. Yeah, so we have the code now. Let's debug it. So this is the easiest way to have a debug console in Adobe Reader. This is just really easy. You have to save this code as a JS file in the JavaScript directory, and then you will have a console window menu item. This is the kind of utility script I was talking about. So this script has trusted. So this script runs in trusted mode too. Okay, so let's review those 22,000 lines of code. And this is what I found. In fact, this is a tricky one, and the real error is not in the code itself, but the whole separation concept between the trusted and untrusted functions. So they run in the same JavaScript runtime, so you can pass any kind of objects you want, and objects can behave interestingly in JavaScript because this is a very dynamic language. So for example, you could have a property that at first returns 1 and then the second time it returns 2, and basically you can do anything with objects. And in this case, the two lines of code here, the this.doc equals doc, is actually can actually be a function call, because as I said earlier, you can define properties, and let's do this. So the last line calls this function in an interesting way. It says the this object to app, and before that we define two properties on the app object. So when the code means this.doc equals doc, then it actually does app.beginPrev null, which is required before it can call a trusted function. And the second line, this.user equals user, it becomes a call to the setter function, which is app.trusted function accidentally, and the setter function is called with the value at the right side of the equal sign, which is user, and we passed f as user. So this is it basically. The only adjustment that is needed is that you cannot really override the doc property on the app object. Because of this, we can do a slight adjustment to the code. Let's define a different object. Let's call it T. And define doc and user on T. Then set the t.proto to app. This makes So JavaScript has prototypal inheritance, which means that every object has a prototype, and the object behaves almost like its prototype, modulo a few things. For example, if you set something on an object, then it will never set that value on the prototype. But in case you read something, you read a property of an object and you cannot find that property on that object, then the runtime will look at the prototype and query that. Yeah. So it steps to the next item in the prototype chain if it doesn't find something. So in this case, T is almost the same as app, except that it has two properties, doc and user. And if you try to query any other properties of T, then you will get the same result as if you were querying the app object, basically. And turns out that this is what actually happens when the code calls these two assignment, and this is almost the same as the idle case, but it works too. So the only difference is that app.beginPriv has T as a this object, but since T is almost identical to app, it is not really problematic. It will work. Okay, so this way we could make our app function trusted. Now what to do with it? I've wrote two different payloads, and one of them just pops up a window and prints the contents of a secret file. The other one reads out the contents of the file and then sends it on the network to somewhere. And this is possible because there are APIs to do this, because you have the utility scripts that may want to do similar things. Okay, demo time. So there are two demos, and one of them is the network-related one, but that is really unreliable. Didn't yet figure out why, but yeah. And this is the pop-up one. And just to see that it really works, here's the file in the nodes directory, and just I will just write some random stuff here.
Cinema. Oh, random stuff.
Cinema. Okay. Let's see. Yeah. The little PDF prints. Okay, so once I discovered the bug, we reported it immediately to Adobe on March 10th, and got an almost immediate response. But I believe that was because we didn't report through the standard form, you know, on their website, but through a friend of Baldi. And I believe if we would have reported it through the standard form, you know, we could have waited for weeks or months, maybe. Which happened several times to me in other projects. And the fix came out on May 13th. And I didn't reverse engineer the patch, actually, but it's on my to-do list. And what they did is probably they probably forbid calling this sensitive function from getter and setter functions, or SO setter and getter function. Okay, and just a few tips for the end. If you want to review their code too and find interesting bugs. So my first tip that is not here is that I believe that there is a lot of space for creativity in this kind of in this space, because JS is very very dynamic language, and you can come up with very creative ways for fooling these checks. So the first one is that property accesses are function calls, as we have seen. Second one is that you can even make this check pass. There is basically, so if you see any kind of check in the Adobe Reader JavaScript code, you can be almost sure that it can be bypassed. in this case, it is because the double equality causes type coercion, and if A is an object, then it calls its toString method. And the first case, the toString method returns X, and the second case Y, and the third case Z. That's it. And yeah, I guess there are few time of check to time of use bugs, which means that, for example, if you see something like this, then you won, basically, because at first sight you might think that this will only print hello world no matter what you do, but this is not true, because this is the same thing. So first time you return this thing, and the second time the property returns this, or I mean anything else you want. I guess there is no such thing in the code, but you might face interesting situations, and sometimes it may come handy. And the last one is that JavaScript proxies are very powerful. So this is not something found in the 1.8 SpiderMonkey version that is embedded in Adobe Reader, but it can be used, for example, in Firefox when you also have privileged JavaScript code, and you can maybe do interesting stuff with it. Yeah, and that's it. Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah. How is this Adobe API? What can you do with it? Except for accessing functional half of or sending stuff via
HTTP? Yeah. Basically, these two things.
These two things. So yeah. It's not like you can search all my disk and reverse my system.
So I would say that 2/3 of these API surfaces are undocumented. So you can find interesting things, but basically I've never been able to write files, for example, or search for specific content in files. You don't know the path of.
So but you cannot open PCP socket or something like that?
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Use system calls or.
Oh, you can do that, but not pure JavaScript.
Yeah, okay. Yes. Maybe they use the A at some point and use Node.js
By the way,
yeah.
don't use V8, but they use the sandbox from Chrome. So this is basically the Chrome sandbox. Yes?
I have absolutely no clue how the Firefox PDF.js works, but it's in a browser, it's Firefox, it's JavaScript.
I don't think that actually runs JavaScript.
It's
not
JavaScript.
They don't just keep all the stuff that's in there.
So you have, yeah.
What difference is that to this?
So you have to be able to execute JavaScript embedded in the PDF,
yes,
to be able to do any of this.
Yes,
and most JavaScript engines, including the PDF.js found in Firefox, doesn't execute JavaScript in PDFs at all. Yeah.
Is there any other viewers?
No other company is clever enough to do
clever.
I think one of the alternative PDF readers implement this, but I'm not sure which one.
How about the KDA Ocular? I think that has JavaScript support.
I don't believe they implement this kind of JavaScript.
It's not implementing JavaScript. The problem is implementing part of the Adobe Reader in JavaScript, so they need privileged functions.
Yes, and the utility scripts.
But in Firefox, I can
if you were able to break out from the, you know, if you were able to run JavaScript from PDF, then you would be able to do HTTP or anything else. Yes. And it has some privileged APIs to Firefox Core because they have to talk somehow to each other, and then you could maybe escalate through that.
Yes, yeah, no.
API.